Previously in part two, we traversed the flutes before reaching the site of the evacuation during the Lane Tree flood. As if she remembered Bert and Dan, the Pecos delivered a storm right on cue.
That's not good.
Coming up in part three, we'll spend a day exploring Lewis Canyon, where we'll find rock carvings that are thousands of years old.
Literally all this is just covered in carvings.
Then on day six, we'll navigate several big rapids before settling down in the beautiful Painted Canyon.
Spot a little weather scare last night. Looks like maybe the worst is behind us, at least for now.
All right, so we are actually ahead of schedule, which is a new experience for me on these longer trips. So we're actually going to spend the day here in Lewis Canyon. We're going to go check out the petroglyphs, the rock carvings, and we're going to walk around, look for arrowheads. We're going to paddle back up river, do a little fishing, and kind of just hang out here for the day, burn a day here, and basically just have a fun day exploring. We've got permission to be on this land, so this is the one opportunity we have to actually get off the river and check out some of the landscape around here. So first things first, I'm gonna take a dump.
That's probably gonna go in the video.
Gotta be very careful if you're climbing around here about where you put your hands. Those rock rattlers like to hang out in the crevices in this rock, and if you put your hand in front of one and startle it, that could be the end of our trip. If you got lost out here and could not find the river, I don't think you'd make it a day. I am just sweating buckets right now. It's so hot. Luckily, it's easy to find the river because it's got these same cliffs we've been seeing the whole trip. But out in this terrain, you could be behind one of these bluffs. You may never find it. You start walking the wrong direction out here and you may die.
Oh!
And this is what happens if you don't watch every single step walking out here.
Oh,
that did not feel good. It's like barbed at the end, dude. I can't get one of these out.
Ow.
It's stuck to me. I got one stuck to my shoe over here too.
Dude, these Interrust crushes, these are thick shoes and it's still going through there. Ow.
Oh, where did that come from?
Yeah, Daniel's got it. He was just telling me, you gotta watch out here, watch your step. About six steps later, he's got one on him.
Like a Band-Aid, bro. Like a Band-Aid. Ah! Ugh. Looks just as bad as when I did it. That's oh, look. Look at your leg. Yeah.
Yep. Welcome to the Pecos River.
Yep, so this is some gnarly stuff right here. I mean, you saw what it just did to me. I didn't even see the plant. I just walked and it felt like something tapped my leg and this stuff just did.
It was stuck in you about five different places.
It is designed to bury itself in you and you travel with it, then it falls off at a later point and that's how it reproduces.
This is the type of draw where the water would have run down during the flood that Dan and Bert experienced. This landscape, there's no soil really, so these types of crevices will fill up with water during a flood, but the ground doesn't soak up any water, so it doesn't take long before this becomes saturated and it just starts pouring into the river canyon. Found another tool that can't tell what it is. It's probably been eroded, but you can tell that it's been worked with another piece of rock. So as important as it is to stay hydrated on the river when you're getting in all the water and you're wet all day, but out here in this dry air, 100 degree heat, you've got to constantly be hydrating or you can find yourself in a bad spot in a hurry. I'm gonna rehydrate, get back out there, see what I can find.
This is purple sage, and a lot of the people that live around here say that when that's blooming, it means rain is on the horizon.
All right, so we're hiking over to the Lewis Canyon petroglyph site. So petroglyphs are basically similar to cave paintings, but instead of paintings, they're actually carvings. And they would carve them on big flat pieces of rock that were out in the open so that they would be visible to the spirits in the sky. And there's actually two different styles that are distinct from one another from two different periods in time.
It's really hard to convey just how extensive this is, but I don't know if you can see it on the GoPro. There's carvings all here, all there,
all the way past Bert. I mean, it's just, there's just dents in this part. I mean, they're everywhere. Literally all of this is just covered in carvings. It's wild how well preserved it's been when it's out in the open like this, getting rained on for thousands of years. It's pretty incredible that it's survived this long.
Oh, one way they can tell, like, their kind of timeline things is that the bow and arrow didn't really make the appearance until 80. And before that, they were using atlatl. So if they were using a bow and arrow, that time places it after year one, basically.
Stuff everywhere, man. It's so crazy.
Yeah, so we have two arrowhead or spear points here. And we were told that one of them points to the horizon where the sun peaks during the winter solstice. And the other one points to the horizon where the sun comes up during the summer solstice.
Which, that's pretty wild to think about, considering, I mean, there's no way they actually knew anything about the summer or winter solstice, but somehow they were able to pinpoint that. Almost makes you wonder if that show Ancient Aliens on History Channel's got a little merit.
Hey, Robert, come here.
What you got?
There's pieces of flint, scraper tool. This is just littered with the artifacts of the time. You just look around.
This little scraper.
Anywhere you look.
Used to maybe skin an animal. Is that typically what this kind of thing was used for?
No,
the scraper?
Just a hand tool of some sort.
Very cool. It makes sense that next to all these carvings would be remnants of arrowheads, scrapers, rudimentary knives, all that sort of thing.
It's important to leave these here.
Yeah, for sure. So, they belong here.
Touch, look, don't take it.
I agree.
All right, so we've had fun exploring, but it is the middle of the afternoon. Super hot, way too hot to be on dry land in this desert. So we're gonna get back in the kayaks, paddle down a little ways, do some fishing, get in the water, and just kind of enjoy the day. This one, second cast over here, I had two following it. They were following it, trying to steal the bait out of his mouth.
Dude, there's two right here. Look, fish on, fish on. Oh, he came off. Those two fish that were chasing this one while I was fighting it were just hanging out, and I just dipped my lure in the water and he nailed it and I caught him too. That is so funny, man. Look at that little guy. We actually have packed just a little bit less food than we thought we needed for the trip. And so since we've got camp set up for the day, we're actually gonna keep a few fish and grill them up tonight over the fire. So this guy, he's gonna be dinner. We're gonna cook up dinner. So hungry, man. This fish is gonna be the icing on the cake. Put a largemouth bass on the half shell.
I never really keep largemouth bass, but in this situation, in this place, it was one of the best meals I've ever had.
It is super windy and hard to sleep. Relentless, like 30-35 miles an hour. It's just loud. I'm tired.
Mm-hmm.
So these are actually long-nosed gar scales, and you can see they kind of have this natural arrowhead shape to them. That's just how they come off the animal, and you can kill one gar and have a bunch of these. That'd be perfect for penetrating a rabbit or squirrel, rat, anything like that. They're extremely sharp. All right, so first thing this morning, we've got what we call Lewis Canyon Rapid. It looks pretty extensive. We can't really see all the way down to scout, but it's big. What are you thinking, Underbrink?
Water level's a little low for this type of boulder garden.
I was just waiting to go down the rapid, waiting until they got clear, made two casts and caught a fish from behind the boulder in this rapid. This place is awesome. The fishing's almost too easy.
Best place to go is we're gonna come in right over here to the right on the other side of those two bigger boulders. You're gonna see that line that runs through the next two big boulders. More than likely, you're gonna shoot just right to the right where the little boulder at the end peaks up, drop in, cut hard left, and then run it out where it gets a little swifter.
We are now entering territory that Bert and Dan have never seen, as their first trip ended before they reached Lewis Canyon. After burning a day there, we have extra water to cover. Day 6 consists of near constant rapids, and with the water level relatively low, certain runs get easier while others get more technical.
That is a big bug.
Some kind of leech, is that what you think they are, or larvae?
Leech or larvae?
They look like leeches to me. There's Waterfall Rapid. Let's go scout this, make sure we don't mess this up. This one looks like an ankle breaker for sure. Goes nothing.
Let it go, Dan, let it go.
I got it. You're good.
Not quite according to plan. The Pecos River, man, doesn't make anything easy.
I thought I tied everything down.
You almost recovered it.
Okay.
Yeah, you
wasn't in water.
And we've made it to Painted Canyon and Painted Canyon Rapids. We'll be camping right above these rapids, and then in the morning we'll be hitting them first thing. Oh, this is a badass camp, man. Home sweet home for the night in Painted Canyon. It may be stormy, but this is one of the more beautiful places I've ever camped in my entire life. Thank you.
haven't portaged a rapid, and that was my only f***ing goal this time.
On day one.
Because when I read y'all's article and y'all were portaging all the rapids, I was like.
No, we portaged one rapid.
But dude, on day one, when you said no portaging or lining rapids, I was just like, there's 0% chance that's gonna happen. But we've done it and it's been fine. Like, we've all just handled it. That's cool, man. On the Devils, we lined and portaged a lot of the rapids.
The thing is it helps to know the river.
It's so fun. I'm like so glad I didn't miss out on any of those rapids.
Coming up in part 4, we spend day 7 exploring Painted Canyon and encounter more of the rich wildlife in the area. Then, on our final day, we'll traverse Painted Canyon Rapids.
He's got his paddle.
The infamous Boulder Gardens and the Weir Dam before meeting Ike Billings at our extraction point.